could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. Over the mountains and the sea, your river runs with love for me. And I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth. Trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise, just to know the saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him.
How I trust Him, how I prove Him.
for grace to trust Him more. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I proved Him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. Oh, for grace to trust Him forgiven, because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven, you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Amazing love, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be to my King would die. Jesus, you are my King. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever breathe. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever breathe. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Oh, you're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. And fill me with your heart and lead. salvation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. Lost are saved, find their way at the sound of your great name. All condemned, feel no shame at the sound of your great name.
Your great name. Father God, we do praise you this morning. We thank you that you've given us another day and another opportunity to come and gather together with brothers and sisters. Lord, we pray that you would speak to us through your word, and just that we would be open to hear whatever it is that you have for us, that we wouldn't have any walls put up or any sin or just lack of surrender that we might be holding back from you, God, but that we would truly give you everything this morning, and that you would examine our hearts before we hear your word, and that we would just be ready to come before you and learn. In Jesus' name, amen.
culture, persecution takes on many different forms, such as ridicule, embarrassment, shame, mockery, insults, physical, mental, and emotional abuse, discrimination, harassment, hatred, violence and deadly assaults, sexual misconduct, and exploitation as well. Now, this list can go on and on and on, and I want to stress the simple fact that persecution of anyone made in the image of God is wrong. So wrong. Because persecution harms our fellow human beings, people who are equal value and worth, just as anybody else is, and every human being is loved by God, cared for by God. And God longs for all of us, the human race, to respond to His love by welcoming His Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ, and also to love one another. And for the believer, this is a sad reality of life, being persecuted. Being attacked and persecuted is a theme we see throughout Scripture. It's a major theme of the Bible is persecution. And our passage this morning deals on that very topic. Now, while we might not be aware of the persecution that takes place throughout the world, here are some statistics from 2022. So in 2022, an advocacy group called Open Doors said at least 360 million Christians experienced high levels of persecution and discrimination. That was 20 million higher than 2021. The group also estimated that the number of Christians killed for their faith rose to 5,898 in 2022, up from the 4,700 killed in 2021. So persecution of the church, of Christians, of God's people, hasn't stopped. And what we see is even in the Old Testament, there is a bent towards destroying God's people. Right? There's a satanic, demonic attack on the children of Israel that we're going to see here. We're going to actually see three different ways that the opposition attacks Israel and the returnees. But just to be refreshed, you know, to a little recap, you know, remember the foundation of the temple has been laid, right? It has been established, and they had a ruckus, right? Worship. It was awesome. It was praising God Almighty. They were worshiping God. It was exciting to be there, even though the Bible states that they were afraid of the surrounding peoples. But their fear of God superseded those things. They were more concerned about what God's will was for them than what the discrimination and harassment that was going to come from the surrounding region towards them. They recognized the walls of the city would not be able to truly save them, but their God Almighty, Yahweh, was the God who was going to get them through all these things. They needed His protection, not the wall's protection. And just as it seemed that things are going according to plan, there's a wrench thrown in there, right? Something disrupts. Opposition rears its ugly head and it halts this project that the Lord has called Israel to. So, let's pick it up in chapter 4, verses 1 through 4, in your outlines this morning. Attack number 1 is cooperate and compromise. Cooperate and compromise. Now the adversaries of Judah and Benjamin heard the descendants of the captivity building the temple of the Lord God of Israel. They came to Zerubbabel, the heads of the fathers' houses, and said to them, "Let us build with you, for we seek your God as you do. And we have sacrificed to him since the days of Esarhaddon, king of Assyria, who brought us here. But Zerubbabel and Jeshua, the rest of the heads of the father's house of Israel, said to them, "You may do nothing with us to build a house for our God, but we alone will build to the Lord God of Israel, as King Cyrus, the king of Persia, has commanded us." Now, this first attack against the people of God, was this friendly, enticing, suggesting cooperation, compromise with their neighbors. "Come, we have worshipped the same God as you. Let us help you." Right? And it doesn't sound, fishy at all. You know, on the surface, we might question Zerubbabel's harsh response. He's like, "No way, man. Not at all. You have no place with us in building of God's house." You know, we might think that it's harsh, but it isn't. This was a subtle, deceptive, and it's a very dangerous scheme, for Scripture says that these neighbors were enemies. They were enemies of the Israelites. They were enemies of these Jews, these returnees from exile. They stood opposed to God's people and their return to the promised land and the rebuilding of their temple. There are two factors here that we must take into consideration that stirred up this opposition against Israel. The first being a settlement of nearly 50,000 Jews were taken from Babylon and are now moving back into the land. This would have been a threat to the power, control, and authority of the surrounding regions. They were claiming back land that belonged to their forefathers, so there were people being, pushed out of the land. And for this reason, political and business leaders, as well as the large landowners, would have strongly opposed the arrival of the Jews back to their land. And our second point that we must take into consideration is the setting which the Jews were returning to was volatile. As the neighboring peoples were obviously anti-Semitic, deeply prejudiced against the Jews. There's always been a hatred of God's people, because through God's people comes God's promises. And if Satan is able to remove God's people from the picture, well, then God's promises cannot come to fruition. But that can never happen, because God is sovereign. He's in control through it all. And as soon as the Jews arrived back into the promised land, this opposition began to take form against them. Right? And it was probably determined to try to, get close and personal with the Israelites. They saw an opportunity to launch, this evil scheme against this building project. Pretending to be friendly and cooperative neighbors, they offered their help to the Jews to build the temple. "Come, let us build together." More hands, right? The faster the work is going to go, right? All these things. They even would go so far as to claim that they worship the same God as them. By worshiping the same God, the temple could serve as their worship center and also the Jews' worship center as well. We understand that's not okay, right? You can't, it's only, there's one true and living God to worship, not many and multiple. But the appearances are not always as they seem. These people were enemies. They were trying to undermine what was happening here and seeking to infiltrate the workforce to derail this building project to some extent. Now, these enemies were the people who had lived in the land since the fall of Samaria, the capital of the northern kingdom of Israel. When the northern kingdom of Israel fell, the Assyrians exiled most of those Israelites. So most of the northern kingdom was exiled, taken out of the land, and the Assyrians would bring in other people groups and mix them all up, right? And so you have what we have today, they're even still around today, the Samaritans are a byproduct of this taking place. Throughout the generations, the Jews that were left behind intermarried with the people groups of other nations, and therefore that's how you get the Samaritans. They became a mixed race down throughout the years, and their religions mixed together as well. Although they claimed to worship the same God as the Jews, in truth they worshiped many so-called gods, all of which are false. They did not worship the only true and living God. We see this perfectly given to us in 2 Kings 17, 32 through 34. So they feared the Lord, and every class they appointed for themselves priests of the high places, who sacrificed for them in the shrines of the high places. They feared the Lord, yet, there should not be a yet there, yet served their own gods according to the rituals of the nations from among whom they were carried away. To this day they continue practicing the former rituals. They do not fear the Lord, nor do they follow the statutes of their ordinances or the law and commandment which the Lord had commanded the children of Jacob, whom he named Israel. So we see this taking place. Now, if the Samaritans were allowed to help them, they would have become close. Friends enough, socializing, mingling together, and eventually wicked lifestyles and false worship of the Samaritan gods would influence the Jews. They recognize this, right? As we should also recognize this danger. And as a result, the Jews, too, would have turned away from the Lord and would have been disciplined and been disobedient to God's word, and they would have been disobeying God's commandment yet again. But note this fact, if the deceptive scheme of the enemy had worked, the decisiveness of the Jewish race would have been lost. However, Scripture says, John 4, 22, you worship what you do not know. Jesus is speaking to the Samaritan woman. You worship what you do not know. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. So it comes through the Jews first. We see that also in Romans chapter 1, verse 16. Now the gift of the Bible, God's holy word, the coming of the Savior of the world, the Lord Jesus Christ, was to come through, right, the Jewish race. Therefore, the Jews return, and these returnees reject the offer of the Samaritans. They reject and they actually want to preserve and maintain holiness. Isaiah 10, 20 through 21, Isaiah prophesied, "And it shall come to pass in that day that the remnant of Israel and such as the escape of the house of Jacob will never again depend on him who has defeated them, but will depend on the Lord, the Holy One of Israel, in truth. The remnant will return, the remnant of Jacob, to the mighty God." It's pretty cool. Now, it's very clear that the Jews saw through the enemy's deceitful plan. And they gave two reasons for rejecting their offer. And I love it because as a pastor, there's a need for tact. There's a need to be able to maybe say no, right, to something so that you can say yes to something else. Or, you need some tact every once in a while, I'm not going to give any examples because they're all going to get me in trouble. Focus. But here, that's what happens, right? They are tactful in their response as well. The Samaritans, number one, their first reason for rejecting is the Samaritans had nothing to do with the temple. They have no part of it. They were not true worshipers of the Lord, for the true worshipers of the Lord worship Him only. Only Him. There is no other gods to worship. There is no other thing to bow down to. It is only the Lord. And the Samaritans did not acknowledge that there is only one and true and living God. And the second point, and I love it, because it's King Cyrus of Persia had commissioned the Jews alone to build the temple. They go, "No, we can't do it." I remember back in the day when my buddies would come over and they would say, hey, Thomas, you want to come over to our house? And I'd be like, nah, I don't really want to, right? I want to go home. And so I would go up to my mom and be like, yeah, Jordan wanted me to come over. Can, what? Say no, right? And it would always, you know, discourage me when she'd be like, yeah, yeah, no problem. It's like, no. Mom, no, say no. But that's kind of what's happening here is they go, hey, listen, the king said we alone can build it. And we're not going to go breaking what his command was. So when we look at this, the first three verses, what is the application for us today? It's a very strong application. It should be a challenging application because compromise of our faith and what we stand for, when we compromise what we stand for, and we start to mingle and socialize and fellowship and even forming partnerships with unbelievers will undermine your Christian lives. It is, you know, we could use an example. I can bring up a chair here and then have my wife come up. And is it easier for me to pull her up onto the stool or for her to pull me down? Always pull me down, right? It's such an important analogy, but it's so important that we understand that we are not to compromise on what we believe, what we hold to, our Christian core values. The school system doesn't care about your children, right? The world doesn't truly care about any of you, right? We find our... God cares so much about you. Now, I shouldn't have blanket statement that schools don't care about you because we have a lot of school teachers. They truly care. But I would argue that it's nigh impossible to truly love a child the way they need to be loved if you don't know Jesus Christ. Truly, truly ministering to them. And God bless you, teachers. Sorry if I offended you. My bad. I'll own it. Yeah, because what it was going through my mind, I don't need to justify myself. Okay, I get it. I messed up. I didn't mean to. Let's just keep going. Stop digging a hole. Oh, I don't even know where I'm at. Well, this is awkward. Yeah, I love you guys too. Yeah, they're like, you're a jerk. Okay. Where was I? I don't know. Compromise. We don't want to compromise. We need to stand up for what is right. No matter the cost. Let us not compromise on our faith. Let us not compromise for what we stand for. I find it so fascinating. The world wants to be involved in the worship of God. However, an unbeliever doesn't worship the same God that we do. They do not worship the same God. So we have to be on our guard. The Bible is so very clear. 2 Corinthians 6, 14 through 18. This is in your outlines this morning. It says, do not be unequally yoked together with an unbeliever. For what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? Think about that for a moment. We're not just speaking of, you know, people getting married. Though if you are interested in somebody and they are not a born-again Christian, no. If you are trying to have a partnership in any sort of business venture with an unbeliever, look at what the Bible says. It says no. Don't do it. Don't put yourself in that situation. Let's keep going. Verse 15, and what accord has Christ with Baal? Or what part of the believer with an unbeliever? And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk among them. I will be their God. They shall be my people. Therefore, come out of among them and be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch what is unclean, and I will receive you. I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. You know, when we look at something along these lines, what I'm not saying is that you cut off all your friendships, right, with the world. But we have to understand that there comes a point where you draw a line in the sand and say, I will not cross that. Because I am set apart, sanctified, holy unto God, and I will not compromise my faith for that. And that's such a hard thing, because what we find in our culture today is too quick to compromise. You know, we joke about it, you know, compromise in marriage, compromise here and there. Compromise is evil. It's not good. Right? There could be an argument made. In this case, it is not good. We cannot compromise on our beliefs. What we're going to find as we continue to study through Ezra is the need to be set apart. I can't stress this enough. They were willing to go to lengths to divorce their foreign wives. Right? We look at him and go, what is going on? And we will talk about it. We will get into the nitty-gritty, to quote Nacho Libre, right? Into it when we get to that last chapter of Ezra. It is a hard thing to come to terms with, but what you will know is that these men and women are taking their holiness seriously, their sanctification seriously. Why are we not? We have been given Jesus Christ. We've been given life and life everlasting. We have been given in the New Testament, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 16, to be holy as He is holy. We have that same call, that same rise to the occasion. Don't compromise. Compromise leads to discipline, because it will ultimately lead us further and further away from God. And He will discipline us to bring us back into that proper standing with Him, that proper relationship. So let's keep going. Verses 4 and 5. But the eye of their God was upon the elders of the Jews, so that they could not make... Did I just skip according? Yeah, let's skip 4. Okay, we'll back up. Then accordingly, we told them the names of the men who were constructing the temple. But the eyes of their God was upon the elders of the Jews. Oh, I'm reading a whole different chapter. Man, this is a rough morning. All right. I had plenty of coffee. I am human, I make mistakes. All right. Chapter 4, verse 4 and 5, then the people of the land tried to discourage the people of Judah. They troubled them in the building and hired counselors against them to frustrate their purposes all the day of Cyrus, king of Persia, until the reign of Darius, king of Persia. So this second attack, as we have up here, is threatened, harassed, and frightened. So if they can't get you to compromise, get you to cooperate with them, get you to accept them and their sin, well, this is the next thing that takes place. They are threatened, harassed, and frightened. The second attack comes now, and they're trying to, they're using intimidation to strike fear in the heart of the Jews. If enough fear is aroused, perhaps they would stop this building project. Now, in day-to-day context, the Samaritans apparently threatened and hassled the Jewish workers, and it's only natural for any Jew who is spiritually weak that lacked determination to give up. What's the point if we, you know, they're trying to frustrate all of our plans to build the house of God? Is it worth it? Right? Should I continue? And so for those that were weak, spiritually weak and lacked commitment, they were likely to quit and go home. But that's not what we see. We see 50,000, nearly 50,000 Jews seriously dedicated to the Lord. And they were not going to stop at all. Now, the specifics of the harassment isn't stated, but most likely they sought to persuade the officials of Tyre and Sidon and the people that were giving them resources to build and furnish the temple upon the Jewish request. Those were probably the routes that they tried to hinder was the resources. Now notice something here. The opposition was not temporary. This wasn't just a single time event. This wasn't one or two attacks. It was persistent persecution and opposition that began in the days of King Cyrus and continued through the reign of King Darius. Ezra 4:24 says, "Thus the work of the house of God, which is in Jerusalem, ceased, and it was discontinued until the second year of the reign of Darius, king of Persia." This means that there is over 20 years of opposition in these two verses. Well, three verses if you include 24. And the conflict would become so fierce that the construction of the temple would stop. It would stop in 530 BC and would not resume until 520 BC. So 10 years, which was the second year of Darius's reign. And the harassment by the Samaritan enemies was successful for a period of time. So what is our application here is what we read at the beginning of our message or in our reading time before the start of the service, before we started singing, John 15:18-25. Looking at just a few of those verses, 18, it says, "If the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love its own. Yet because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecute me, they will also persecute you." This is true, family. I know that while we are coming up against opposition, there can be this sense of fear, or a sense of dread, but we must not be overcome by fear, and neither by the harassment or threats of our enemies. Whether our enemies are men, spiritual foes, the culture, right? We must not allow the fear of those things to distract us, to deter us from our love and walk and trust in God. The fear that we are discussing is not the fear that we might experience coming across a snake, like a rattlesnake, right? If you came across a rattlesnake, there's a healthy fear of going, hey, probably shouldn't mess with this thing because it's going to kill me, right? Like there's a healthy sense of fear, but here what we're talking about is the fear that drives us further from our God, further from His Word, further from trusting in Him. This type of fear must not be allowed to dominate our lives, to defeat us, to discourage us, or to make us feel helpless. This is a very clear teaching in God's Word. Now, God loves us and cares for us, and His promises, He promises to give us strength to stand against those tides. Now, I pray that your heart would be encouraged by these verses that we look at, and I would encourage you to write these things down. Matthew 10:30-31. "But the hairs of your head are all numbered. Do not fear, therefore, you are more valuable than many sparrows." And in your outlines, 2 Timothy 1:7-8, "For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind." And it keeps going in verse 8. It says, "Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but share with me in the sufferings of the gospel according to the power of God." Psalm 91:2-6, it says, "I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge, my fortress, my God, in him I will trust. Surely he shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. He shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you shall take refuge. His truth shall be your shield and buckler. You shall not be afraid of the terror by night, nor of the arrow that flies by day, nor of pestilence that walks in darkness." nor of the destruction that lays waste at noonday. And then this is one of my favorite ones, Isaiah 12:2. Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid, for Yah, the Lord, is my strength and song. He has also become my salvation. See, these are the promises of God, that you can trust Him. And family, I sound like a broken record, I know, but you will truly not be the first person in human history to prove God a liar. Right? You won't be able to prove God a liar. He will get you through the good times and the hard, difficult, dark night of the soul nights. Both good and the bad, God will see you through. So much more to talk about there, but let's keep focus. Can we say today, as Isaiah 12:2 stated, I will trust and not be afraid? It is so easy for us to get to be like Peter walking on water. He sees the Lord walking on water and he goes, Lord, if it's really you, call me out. Call your servant out. Let me come out to you. Let me also walk on water. And he's like, all right, come on, let's go. Come with me. Come. Peter gets out of the boat, right, and he starts to walk. What does he do immediately? He takes his eyes off the prize. He stops looking at Jesus, the author and finisher of his faith. Oh, talk about spiritual analogy. Right? He takes his eyes off of Jesus, placing his trust in himself and looking out, and he sees the waves and he begins to sink. And I love our Lord so much, because what did Jesus not do? He didn't go, I told you so. Come on, man. Right? Like, what's wrong with you? Why would you take your eyes off of me? I am it. I am the Messiah. He goes, all he says is, help me. Right? And what it says, immediately, Jesus pulled him out. It's like, I got you. Right? What a beautiful thing that no matter what we do, even in our moments of fear, distrust of God, He remains faithful when we are faithless and unfaithful. That we can truly say, as Isaiah said, behold, my God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid, for Yah, the Lord, is my strength and my song. He also has become my salvation. We can hold on to those things. Let's keep going. We're going to start in verse 6 of the right chapter this time. And this third attack is falsely accused and slandered. Now in the reign of Ahasuerus, in the beginning of his reign, they wrote the accusation against the inhabitants of Judah and Jerusalem. Now Ahasuerus is Xerxes. This is Esther's husband. Right? So just so you guys know what's going on. What we have here in verses 6 through 23 is an interjection. So now they're giving an overview of all of the persecution that's going to take place. We're talking about from the time of Zerubbabel all the way through to the time of Nehemiah. Right? So we're going to tackle a big chunk of time in this section right here. In verse 7, in the days of Artaxerxes, Bishlam, Mithridat, and Tabal, and the rest of the companions wrote to Artaxerxes, king of Persia, the letter, which was written in Aramaic script and then translated to Aramaic language. And Rehum, the commander of Shimshai, and the scribe, wrote the letter against Jerusalem to Artaxerxes in this fashion. Right? So what is taking place, again, is that verses 4 through 23 is this broad overview of the Samaritan resistance. Yeah, it's terrifying. And in these sections, right, we're going to find... For several years during the reign of Cyrus to the reign of Darius. Darius ruled from 522 to 486. And now there are two other kings that are described as well. There is Xerxes or Ahasuerus that ruled from 486 to 465. So what we have in kingly procession is we have King Cyrus, King Darius, right? And we have Ahasuerus or Xerxes, Esther's husband, and then we have Artaxerxes. So what we have here is there was a letter written to Xerxes, Esther's husband, and also there's nothing seemed to come of it, probably because, Esther, right? It was his wife's people were being persecuted, right? So he didn't do anything about it, these accusations. So Artaxerxes comes after that. And this third attack against the Jews was to bring false accusation, slander, even after the temple has already been completed. Remember verse 24. Verse 24 tells us that the temple was finished in the second year of Darius. All right? So trying to keep track of everything, I know it can be difficult sometimes. We have the Samaritans starting to hinder the work of the Lord during the reign of Cyrus. The temple gets put on pause until the second year of Darius, 10 years later. Boom. Finally, the temple gets rebuilt. And now, when we look back at verses 6 through 23, now we're looking at two different kings and two different letters that were written to them. We don't have the letters that was written to Ahasuerus, but we do have the one written to Artaxerxes. And so, to keep this kind of simple, they blame the Jews. They say that they are a rebellious people, that the city, if rebuilt, would be, it would cut them off from all of the rest of that land, right? So right after during the reign of Artaxerxes, another letter, what we see here in verses 9 through 16, is this letter that is seeking support. These three convinced the two highest ranking Persian officials of the local province to write a letter. So we have Bishlam, Mithridat, and Tabel being local leaders, getting their higher ups to write a letter to Artaxerxes. Artaxerxes reads this letter and does the research, right? And in the beginning of the letter, the governor, secretary state their grievance against this small, isolated group of Jews. And so in addition to the complaints coming from not only local, right, these local three leaders, you have these higher-ups of the region, but notice that you also have other ones. Look with me in verse 9. From Rehum the commander, Shimshai the scribe, and the rest of the companions, representatives of the Danites and the Abrastrites and the Tarpalites and the people of Persia and Ekra and Babylon and Shushan, Devites, the Emalites, and the rest of the nations, whom the great and noble, I don't know how to say this name, so I'm going to just say, oh snapper, took captive the settled in the cities of Samaria and the remainder beyond the river and so forth. And what we find here is that there are other people groups even included. They go, we all don't like the Jews. We're all of one accord. Make them stop. Make them stop. Now, the writers of this letter are concerned with the welfare of the king and the empire. And they make five accusations. In verse 12, the accusation is the Jews were rebuilding a rebellious city of Jerusalem, restoring its walls, repairing its foundation. Verse 13, if the city and its walls were rebuilt, the Jews would rebel and refuse to pay their taxes. Verse 14, the honor of the king was at stake. Therefore, they were informing him of the danger that was on the horizon if the Jews continued to rebuild their nation. Verse 15, a search of the royal records would reveal the Jews were, in fact, a very rebellious people, which was the very reason that Jerusalem had been destroyed earlier. And our fifth one is in verse 16. We find that the rebellious Jews might lead a revolt and the king might lose all of the land west of the Euphrates. Now, after receiving this letter, Artaxerxes does his research. He does find out that, yes, these things that they were saying of the past were true, but that was not the Jewish intention. Right? And so he orders an immediate stop. Right? And as soon as the king's words reached the local government and the secretary, they took immediate action. And sadly, the returned exiles were compelled to stop building Jerusalem. And the military forces were used to stop them from doing this work. Apparently, this meant destroying certain sections that have already been built. Look at this with me. At Nehemiah 1:3, and they said to me, "The survivors who were left in captivity in the province there are in great distress and reproach. The walls of Jerusalem is also broken down, and its gates are burned with fire." So this probably took place, burning the gates and tearing down the walls, probably took place due to this statute given by King Artaxerxes. Now, it's important to note that long before the work order was given to stop rebuilding Jerusalem and its walls, the rebuilding of the temple had also halted. We already talked about that. Talk about ongoing persecution. You know, this is a span of 60, 70, pushing 80 years of persecution from different people. And we're going to see that it's a major theme of the book of Nehemiah as well. But family, when we are rightly walking with God, when we are accomplishing what God wants us to do, which is go therefore make disciples of all nations, baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teach them all that I commanded you, and lo, behold, I will be with you even to the end of the age. When we go and we're about our Father's business, winning men and women's souls for the kingdom of God, we are always going to be met with opposition after opposition, attack after attack. Because when we are walking rightly with God, accomplishing the work that He has given us, we will be persecuted. We will be slandered. We will suffer to some degree persecution, falsely accused, lied about, slandered, ridiculed, and mocked, rumors and gossips about us. We will be embarrassed and shamed. Persecution may also involve physical violence, assault, or perhaps even call upon the price of our lives, to lay down our lives. We need to keep this in mind, that we seek to keep the commandments of God. What He has given us, the statutes that He has given us as New Testament, New Covenant saints, living a righteous and holy life, that those who live in sin and wickedness are bound to oppose us. Look at this verse with me. John 3:18-21. "He who believes in Him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that the light has come into the world, and men loved darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone practicing evil hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his deeds be exposed. But he who does the truth comes to the light, and his deeds may be clearly seen, that they have been done in God." In your last fill in the blank is in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 10 through 12. Starting in verse 10, it says, "But you have carefully followed my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, love, perseverance, persecutions, afflictions, which happened to me at Antioch and Iconium and Lystra. What persecutions I endured, and out of them all the Lord delivered me. Verse 12, yes, and all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. This begs the question, if we are rightly walking with God, where are we being persecuted? Right? Where is that? Or have we started to compromise? Have we started to compromise on our faith? Have we not been taking the stand that we should? I get it. There needs to be, there's a time and place for everything. But we have to be bold. Do you fear man more than God? It's a slippery slope. I love this verse, and we'll close here and ask the worship team to come on up for this closing song. But Romans 4:14-9. For none of us lives to himself, and no one dies to himself. For if we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. Therefore, whatever we live or die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and rose and lived again, that he might be the Lord both of the dead and of the living. And so family, again, the theme of Ezra is to remain holy unto the Lord, to be set apart from the world. We don't want to act like the world. You know, we don't want to smell like the world. We don't want anything to do with ungodliness. However, that doesn't negate the fact that we, our job is to slog through it, to walk through this world, giving the gospel, saying, "Will you, you need Jesus? He'll save you. Believe and confess that he is Lord. He will redeem you." Right? Because all who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It's a beautiful gospel message that we get to hold on to, that we get to participate in. And again, family, if there's, at the end of our services, we're going to be offering prayer. And if you need prayer this morning, go to our prayer corner. It's back there. And there'll be someone there willing and ready to pray with you. Family, let's all stand as we close with this last song. And of course, Numbers 6, 24 through 26. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Father, we do thank you so much for your goodness, your grace, your mercy, your long-suffering, God, that you are truly the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. There is none like you. And Father, we want to honor you and praise you and glorify your name. Help us to remain separate from the world. Let us not compromise on what you have established in your word, God, that we would never compromise on your word. And Father, please go before us. Help us to be your hands and feet, Lord, to this dying world. Lord, help us. In your precious name, amen. All right, let's worship the Lord together.